take a second and think about how many items of plastic or styrofoam do you encounter slash use a day? Put that number in the chat. Now think about what is one problem styrofoam use could cause in the world. Styrofoam is a huge problem for the world. As you can see here, 37 million tons of plastic is used every year, and 70% of that is sent to landfills. Recently, in March of 2022, a research study found microplastics inside of 77% of human participants' blood. So, what can be done? Well, did you know that mealworms can eat styrofoam and other plastic? Yes, they can. And that's what AP Biology researchers at our school have been studying since 2019. In our background research, we read that the amount and rate of styrofoam that mealworms eat per worm is known. There is a bacteria in the guts of the worms that is what actually digests the plastic, and mealworms select different types of foods on nutritional value. But when the prior AP Bio students started this research, they couldn't find anyone who cared about the mealworms and their survival when they ate styrofoam. So that's what they decided to research, in particular these two questions about the effect of eating styrofoam on different parts of the mealworm's life cycle. Here is a diagram that shows the four stages of a mealworm's life cycle, from egg to mealworm to pupae, like a cocoon, to darkling beetle, and back to egg again.
In the year pre-COVID, students collected data for months on three treatment groups: a control group with bran, a group with 4% styrofoam, and a group with only styrofoam. There were 15 groups of 20 worms. You can see this in the graph that there was a significant difference among the bran only and 4% styrofoam group in the mass of their pupil, which may mean the styrofoam impacted their ability to gain mass. You can also note that only 4 pupas emerged out of 300 worms. The rest of the worms died. How did they die? Well, the worms in the styrofoam only group eventually started cannibalizing each other, as you can see here. Also, you can see this graph that 4% mixture treatment significantly impacted the date, the time that it took for the worms to form their pupae. To avoid mass worm death, the students of 2019 through 2020 tasked us with looking at different percentages of styrofoam, 2%, 4%, and 6%, to see if the trends were the same, and to avoid mass mealworm death by only giving them styrofoam again. And you can see our only basic procedures here.
But reading about our procedure is no fun, so we made a stop motion video to present our procedure to you all. On a bright and sunny September day, the mealworms in our lab supplies were delivered to HSTAT.
Ouch! Where are we? Can you get off my legs?
Yay! Mealworms are here!
And now, we see Miss Beck has shown the mealworms to the class for the first time.
Yuck, I'm not touching those, no way.
Why are you so offended? You should be scared of me, humans!
And that, my fellow scientists, is where our mealworms journey begins. You can see here, as students sort the mealworms into their control group cup, no styrofoam, and the three experimental groups, 2%, 4%, and 6%, respectively. 20 worms go into each cup, and there are 10 cups of each treatment.
Whee! Whoa, this human is big. Hi, new neighbors!
Here, we see a student going through the daily lab procedure, removing the mealworms from the incubator that controls their temperature and humidity. In the beginning, the students were afraid of the mealworms.
I'm scared of bugs.
And we suspect that the worms were pretty scared of the humans too.
Ah! Giant attack!
But with time, they both got comfortable. Here you can see the students counting the worms of a single cup to see how many are alive, and then weighing them all together to find their mass. Students recorded this every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Sometimes when counting, students noticed that a pupae, the next stage of the life cycle, had formed.
I feel funny. Whoa, that was cool!
If a pupae was found, it was weighed itself and transferred to a new cup. These pupae were color-coded to identify them, and watch to see how long it would take for them to hatch.
If ever.
The beetles emerge light-colored and darken with time. They are weighted and transferred to a new cup together. Sometimes, the beetles don't get along and fight each other to the death.
This is my starful! Dieful!
But sometimes the beetles get along very well. And me.
I think I love you.
Then the cycle starts again and we watch the eggs hatch. We then have to count the worms that emerge from counting all the tiny, tiny little babies. Sadly, at the end of our semester, we had to humanely euthanize the worms. We did this by freezing them, and we even had a beautiful funeral for them. In the second semester, we learned how to input all of our data into Excel, and then analyzed it for trends. We hope that the bugs' lives and our work has had a great impact on the world.
Now that you've seen our process, let's see and hear some testimonials about how the experiment went for them from our classmates.
I gained a lot of leadership experience by caring for the worms and working together with our group because we would communicate to make sure that there were no flaws in the experiment and we would work together to make sure that we were handling the worms correctly. And over time, I became a better scientist because in the beginning, I was very hesitant and scared of the worms, but then I became more experienced and handled the worms correctly.
I totally agree with her and I just want to add on that I just really feel like a scientist for the first time. I would never have thought, but I was able to gain this amount of experience before even reaching a stage of college or a future career. And I think this will give me the ability to lead an experiment in the future and analyze data with it.
And now for this year's research results. You can see here the change in the number of mealworms larvae and pupa formation over time for our experiment, which lasted almost 100 days. These graphs are very similar, but are slightly different because not all worms turned to pupa. Some died, but you can see in the bottom corner. In the other bottom corner, you can see Trush from NYU, who helped us with understanding how to graph this data and analyze it in his monthly visits to our classroom. We noticed a difference in groups around day 42, so we decided to look at that more closely. On day 42, there was a significant difference with a p-value of less than 0.01 among our research groups. In particular, there was a difference in the number of larvae alive on day 42 between the groups with 6% styrofoam and all the other groups. There were not any significant differences between the mass of the larvae on days 42 or at the end of our experiment though. There also appears to be a significant difference among the groups when it comes to their number of days that they are in the pupa stage, with the groups with 2% and 4% styrofoam in the pupa stage for less than the other groups, confusingly for us. So we looked at the pupa's mass, which had no significant difference among groups, but with our control group and 6% styrofoam groups getting close with a p-value of 0.12. Our beetle mortality data was unreliable because the beetle really liked killing each other. You can see here there was no significant difference between groups in the mass of their beetles. And we tried our best to look at the numbers of offsprings these beetles made, but the beetles like eating their babies, and the babies are so small that it will take all period for us to try to accurately count them.
So given all of this, what are our future plans? Given our data, we still need to do more research to see if mealworms can be considered from the perspective of the mealworm and its life cycle as an effective solution to plastic waste pollution. One option for next year's students is to repeat our experiment from this year and see if we get similar results, in particular the group with 2% styrofoam. We also can do the experiment with a wider range amount of styrofoam, perhaps 5%, 10%, and 15%. Another option is to do the experiment with a different type of plastic, like plastic packaging material. Finally, we want to figure out a way to analyze the cells of our dead frozen worms to see if groups have different amounts of styrofoam. Please let us know if you have any other ideas of next steps for us or any other feedback.